Hello, I'm Philip Cohen, here to talk today about race and racism in America. I'm going to talk mostly about blacks and whites to explain general concept of race and racism. But first, I want to get into a little bit how the attitude of and ideals around race and racial identity have changed so much in recent years.
Moi je joue, moi je joue à joue contre joue. Je veux jouer à joue contre vous, mais vous voulez-vous? De tout cœur, je veux gagner ce cœur à cœur. Vous connaissez mon jeu par cœur, alors défendez-vous. Sans tricher, je vous le promets. J'ai gagné, tant pis c'est bien fait, vous êtes mon jouet. À présent, ce ne sera plus vous mais toi. Et tu feras ça, t'apprendras n'importe quoi pour moi. Sans m'en faire, je vais t'assurer un enfer. De griffes et de crocs, tu crieras bientôt au secours. Alors décidant de ton sort, pour m'éviter quelques remords, je t'aimerai plus fort. Oh oui, plus fort.
Now, I'll leave it to you whether you think that ad is charming and idealistic or cynical and devious on the part of a capitalist company making money off of people's quest for self-understanding. But what's interesting for our purposes is how the model, Nikia Phoenix, was treated after the ad came out.
For the past few days, dealing with these Instagram racists that are coming at me because of the beautiful 23andMe commercial, they don't like me. To be more specific, they hate the human race. They hate the mixing of races and cultures. They don't like humanity at all. They don't like this global community that we have. So let's fight them. I'm not saying that we respond to them because you can't reason with people who aren't there. What I'm saying is let's fight them with love. Let's fight them with light. Let's fight them with this soul, this universal energy that we share. Ooh, it does give me chills though, because not for the reasons you may think. I'm not scared. But what I am is very happy, because that means that the message is resonating and vibrating even to them.
Okay, so that sets the stage a little bit. We're fascinated with racial identity, identity questions in general, the issue of authenticity and what's real and who we really are. And when it comes to race, that's a problem because the racial categories we use are not very real. There are a lot of pictures like this of couples where one parent is Black-ish and one is white-ish, and they have some kind of mixed ancestry, and they have children who look different. So this is one couple which was especially extreme in the United Kingdom, who had two sets of twins, and in each pair of twins, one looked whiter and one looked blacker, and if you separated them, you might think one was white and one was black. So it sort of went to show the arbitrariness of our categories, the mystery of our genetics, and what that all means for racial identity, and ultimately, for our purposes, racial inequality, which is where we're trying to go. You'll learn, if you have not already learned in the sociology class or in high school or wherever, that race is socially constructed, that it's that the categories are not biologically real. That's true, we're gonna talk about that. However, there is a biology involved in this, and sociologists and people interested in sociology need to understand at least some of that biology to be able to put this whole conversation, this whole area of knowledge, and this whole set of political and social issues in the proper context. So I'm gonna talk about that maybe a little bit more than most other people do when they teach this material. So the race categories that we have are relatively recent, somewhere around the 18th century. They've changed now and then, but they usually look something like this, and I apologize for the offensive graphic. I'm not gonna have more of that in this slideshow. This roughly 18th century idea was defined races according to the continents where people came from, more or less. Europe, Africa, Asia, the Americas, and Australia, the Pacific Islands. Now, the key thing about this picture, and it's obvious in this picture, which is what I'm using, is that whites are at the center. Whites are in this evolutionary sense that people were thinking of when these ideas were being developed, especially after Charles Darwin's ideas of evolution became popular. The idea of whites was that they were the most evolved, evolved in the sense of biology. And the reason that people thought this, that white people thought this, was because whites were the richest and most powerful people of the world. Also, the whites were naturally developing a worldview that put themselves at the center and also made themselves the hero of the story, which is the normal way that people think. And when people are very powerful, then they promulgate that ideology and that way of thinking to everybody else. So the racial categories were always, from their inception, hierarchical. That is, there's never been a racial categorization that did not involve hierarchy. And the ranking was biological or cultural or some combination of the two, with always whites at the top. Okay. So now the social construction of race is acknowledged by almost all social scientists, but what that is a little bit complicated. What does it mean to be constructed when we're talking about biological concepts or ostensibly biological concepts? So let's look at that a little bit more. A little bit of ancient history. The migration of early humans. Well, for a couple of hundred thousand years, what we basically would consider modern humans, people who are anatomically like us or Homo sapiens, lived in Africa without leaving Africa or without leaving Africa very much. So for a few hundred thousand years, they moved all around Africa. They were separated from each other for many, many centuries so that differences evolved between the people living in different parts of Africa. The population of Africa became extremely diverse during that time, much longer than there had been people out of Africa. There were people all over different parts of Africa. Then only very recently, relatively speaking, less than 100,000 years ago, maybe 65,000 years ago, was the major migration of humans, modern humans, biologically modern humans, out of Africa. You can see on the map, they left East Africa, traveled across into the Middle East, then into Europe, and finally east to Asia, Australia, and eventually the Americas on the land bridge, relatively recently, 15 or 16,000 years ago, coming to this continent. So all of that in biological terms is just to say that the populations outside of Africa are very recent. They're really a small offshoot of humanity that has kind of exploded in recent times and become big populations of people in Europe and Asia and the Americas. But that key, the key thing about the origins of humanity in Africa is that it was there for humans were there for a long time and became extremely diverse biologically in terms of evolution. Okay. Now, I just want to point out when I say diverse and biological and evolution, we're talking about still in the grand scheme, relatively minor differences. Humans are one species, okay? When you separate any members of one species into separate groups for a long time for many generations, differences evolve, okay? Doesn't mean the differences are all very functional. They could just be random. I'll talk a little bit about that later. But this is from the lab of the human geneticist Sarah Tishkoff at the University of Pennsylvania, who's been studying genetic diversity in Africa, and I'll talk more about her work in a minute. But just to show the amazing diversity of phenotypes, of what people look like, of what their physical appearance is across Africa, a whole range of different, whatever you want to talk about people's appearance, it varies a lot in Africa. So one of the greatest sort of crimes of just understanding the world is the idea of Africa as one place, is the idea of Africa as undifferentiated, the idea of Africa as something like a race when there's this vast diversity within Africa. Now, here's a little experiment for you to think about. If you were a 19th century or just any old racist scientist and you looked at this, you were like, I've got to make sense of all this diversity. What might you do? Well, you might reorder these pictures from light to dark. Okay, that would be just, that would be ridiculous scientifically, but it would just be going by the one sort of visually obvious characteristic. That's really a lot of what racial thinking is. And you'd say, aha, okay, so we've ordered them from light to dark, sort of from higher to lower, incidentally, maybe not on purpose. And now we're going to start thinking, you know, categorizing these different groups of people. That's kind of racial or racist thinking about human diversity. Okay. The amazing thing about human diversity, we have a lot of diversity, but most of the diversity we have is still within Africa. So it's not that we have a lot of, we have diversity everywhere, but if you really want to see diversity, look within Africa. And that's a function of how long people have lived in Africa. So this is a kind of graph that Sarah Tishkoff and her colleagues did this, that human or the geneticists do. Each of those tiny little lines is one person of the 2,432 Africans whose DNA they sampled. And the colors show the kind of clusters of DNA that they have. Now again, these are relatively superficial differences in most cases, right? They're all humans, they're all the same species, they're all, you know, okay, but there are differences that come from populations living apart. Okay, little tiny genetic variations that get stuck to one population or another. So the amazing thing is she's got 14 sort of distinct genetic clusters here that you can find spread out across Africa with pretty substantial differences between them. And when you compare this to world diversity is when you see the magnitude of diversity within Africa. One of the things that they studied is skin color. And skin color, people think race is about skin color. Well, sort of. On the other hand, if you're going to have one category of black, which you're going to say is Africans, then it doesn't make sense to go by one category of skin color, because there's tremendous diversity of skin color within Africa. And one of the fascinating things that Sarah Tishkoff and her colleagues found was that the genes for light and dark skin both had origins way before modern humans. That is, before modern humans, which are only about 300,000 years old, before all that, the human type beings that there were in Africa had the genes for having lighter skin or darker skin. And in fact, probably the very earliest Homo ancestors, way before modern humans, a couple of million years ago, were probably not darkly pigmented. That is, the first primates to come down from the trees and wander around the savanna had hair, then they lost their hair because it got too hot. Eventually they evolved to have less hair and more sweat glands, and then they probably evolved to have darker skin, which protects them from skin cancer, particularly in places with a lot of sun. So the idea of like dark and primitive and old is just not true. It's not that humans started with dark skin and then evolved to have lighter skin. We've always had the genetic capacity to have lighter or darker skin depending on where we live and what kind of skin is healthiest for us in our environment. Okay, last thing on genetic diversity in the world. This idea of the five races is really just a white view of the world. That's really when you're sitting in Europe or the United States, you're trying to understand all the distant people who don't really make sense to you. You might come up with this idea of five races. This Tishkoff and her colleagues again took all those Africans that they had sampled, and then they got a bunch of people, DNA from people around the world, and you can see they clustered them. The cool thing here is there are 14, again, that's just a coincidence, there are 14 sort of genetic clustered groups around the world, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them are in Africa, and that are is sort of essentially as distinct as the other groups are from each other, or as the other groups are from Africans. Then you've got Europe, Middle East, Yemen, Central Asia, India, East Asia, Oceania, Australia, and Americas. Okay, so you could sort of, if you wanted to use genetic clustering to kind of create categories, you definitely would not do this five category thing that we started with, that was just a racist construction to explain white superiority. You could try to think about other ways to cluster them. You might get something like 14 groups. You wouldn't even really call them races because there's not enough genetic difference between them, but you could find 14 or so genetic clusters. Okay. And again, the key thing about that is a lot of them are in Africa and they're different from each other. Okay, so this is all just a lesson to say the white view of the world, the white view of science and genetics sort of completely undermine any capacity to actually understand what human diversity is like. Now, you will have heard, and I've said, and other people will say, that race is a social construction. On the other hand, You may be confused by that because you don't think you're crazy. You definitely think you can look at people and see that they look different, that there are differences. Yes, there are differences between humans. Those differences actually do kind of correspond in some ways to the regions where people's ancestors came from. That's just because, again, if you separate people into different groups, like any other species into different groups, you leave them separated for a while, little differences will evolve. Okay, what we don't end up with, and especially in the short amount of time that humans have been out of Africa, what we don't end up with is distinct genetic races that are clearly identifiable with category, with boundaries between them that can be determined by genetics. But there are some variations. The key thing about this is there's two kinds of variations. Now, this is very simplistic genetics. Some are just sort of random, right? You put people in one place, you put people in another place, and you get sort of random variation, right? Things that happen to stick over time for no real reason. And others are changes that occur sort of under selection. That is, some random variation occurs, and the people who have it are a little bit more likely to survive or less likely to survive. And so the population changes a little over time. That's like evolution, okay? Now, in the grand scheme, these variations are really pretty minor. Again, in humans, not that long, that we've only been out of Africa for a little while. We just don't have these huge differences between these different groups. So, and then during a lot of that time, people have been already remixing up. And so we just don't have distinct categories anymore biologically. But you can see there is evidence of evolution happening within humans. Humans are a species like any other species. This is a great, I like this map because it just shows some of the things that evolved in particular places. They don't create separate races. They're just little things that turned out to be useful or not useful in different areas. For example, in a couple different parts of the world, people evolved lactose tolerance or lactase persistence. That is, they can drink milk as adults and it's not bad for them, essentially. Okay, and that's because that turned out to be useful, or it was selected for, that people who had that trait were more likely to survive because they were drinking milk from animals. In other cases, people in mountain areas have developed, have genetically adapted to thrive better at high altitudes. Skin pigmentation is just one of these things. It turns out to be very important for us visually, and it is important for survival. If you live in the sunniest parts of the world around the equator, it's really helpful to have dark skin especially skin cancer, but also folates, it's a long story. If you're not living in the very sunny regions of the world, you might want to have lighter skin so you can really get that vitamin D that you need from the little bit of sunlight that you have. Okay, you can see some other things that evolved around here, dealing with particular parasites like malaria, kinds of food, and so on. So I like this list. It shows, yes, people evolve. There are little differences between groups of people, but there's nothing big like, you're not going to find one group of people that were selected for being like smarter or stronger another group that was not. I mean, that everybody benefits from those things no matter where they are. What we have is like small variations that kind of caught on because the people who had them tended to survive. Okay, but nothing to create big genetically distinct populations that you can really easily categorize separately. Okay, now in practice, there's a complicated dance with race between self-definition and social definition. What do I think I am and what do other people think I am? Right, and so, and this really undermines any biological concept of race. And nothing illustrates that better than the one drop rule or the so-called rule of hypodescent in the United States, where if anybody can tell you're black, anybody can tell you have black ancestors, you're black. Okay, now if you're thinking biologically, that's ridiculous, of course, and you would not want to do that. If you are interested, for example, in does this medication possibly have different effects on people of African ancestry and European ancestry, that may be a reasonable question at some times, not if you just ask people, what race do you think you are? That would not be the way to do that. Okay, so the rule of hyperdescent is why we have had a black president who was Barack Obama, who of course had a white American mother and a black African father. In the United States, we have the one drop rule, the rule of hyperdescent, so that the children who were the offspring of enslaved people would be considered slaves rather than free, so that the slave owners who raped the women that produced the children would not lose property, essentially. So their female slaves would produce children that were property, that were slaves, that could do work and could be sold, rather than free people who would, they did not, would just like mess up the family tree from the point of view of the racist whites. Okay, so the one-drop rule is very idiosyncratic to the black-white situation in the United States around the time of slavery, and we're just stuck with it as tradition and as part of racial and racist ideology. Makes no sense biologically. It's a great example of how this whole thing doesn't make sense biologically. Okay, to sum up a little on biology, society, and race, despite genetic diversity associated with ancestral origins, which is real, there is diversity associated with where people's ancestors came from in the world, human races are not real biological categories. There is biological diversity. There are genetic differences between people in different parts of the world, but there are not racial categories that match the common conception of racial categories. In fact, there are no racial categories that scientists can really discern with fixed or firm boundaries that are clearly demarcated. Okay. However, human races are real social categories, extremely real, with real consequences, okay? So in the relative hierarchical nature of the racial system that we have, the categories are very real, their consequences are very real, the inequalities, the health disparities in income and wealth, that racial segregation and school segregation, and all that is very real, and it follows from the social determination of these racial categories, which are, and always have been, hierarchical. Okay, the system was designed to be hierarchical, to communicate the hierarchical status of different groups in the world. That said, we absolutely have to study race and the effects of race and racism so we can deal with those problems and address them politically and socially. But we have to do that without treating the categories that underlie them as somehow natural or fixed or right or good. Right, so we know these are real categories socially, but we know they are not real biologically, in the sense that they're not fixed, they don't have firm boundaries, that biological differences between these groups are small, and we can't even draw the line between the groups in any way that corresponds to the social conception of these categories. But they're very real and we have to think about them. So it's a contradiction, it's a conflict for any of us who want to either study race and racism or address race and racism, that we're working with categories that we really don't like. So we end up with a couple of definitions of the word race. In one sense, race is a system. It's a system that humans created to classify groups of people based mostly on skin tone or other related traits, I would add, in a hierarchical way. Okay, so that's race is a system. Then there are groups within that system who are groups of people that are believed to share common descent. So people assume they came from some common ancestry, and they are perceived to have innate physical similarities. So if a group has some physical thing that people think makes them into a group and it gives them common ancestry. That means, for example, if you're a short African-American, but there's a common myth, and it is a myth, that blacks are tall in America, then that will be considered a deviation from the normal tall African-American situation, right? Or any other, if you have especially light skin, if you're African-American, especially dark skin, if you are not African-American, then you might be considered, you know, to have something unusual about you, but it doesn't shake the definition. So the group has a perceived group of similarities that people think of as defining the category, even when it's mythical. Right? That's why I use the example of these basketball pictures where Shaquille O'Neal, and of course, many, many basketball players are very tall and are disproportionately black. And that contributes to a myth that black people in America are taller than white people. Not true. Okay. On the other hand, if you look at Yao Ming, obviously extremely tall, 7'6" person from China, much higher than average. We don't go around thinking, wow, Chinese people are all tall. Okay. We consider him to be a deviation from the normal. Okay. So race is a system of thinking, and race is also a group of people defined by that system of thinking. I'm not going to talk a lot about ethnicity, but just to differentiate race from ethnicity, ethnicity is cultural. So it's a group of people with a common cultural identification based on something like language or religion or ancestry or the traditional practices and beliefs and behaviors. There's obviously a lot of slippage between race and ethnicity here. Once a racial group has an identity and they live together and they develop habits and practices and traditions together, then they are also ethnic. So you certainly couldn't say African Americans in America are a race and not an ethnic group. There's an ethnic component to that. So there's race and there's ethnicity, which are sort of overlapping, but one is about the perceived body types and body characteristic biological stuff, and one is cultural stuff. Okay, so if we're gonna talk about race and racism, we have the bad parts, which are the isms. We have ethnocentrism, that is the belief that one's group and values and behaviors are right. That's putting yourself and your group in the middle of the world and making you the heroes of the story. It's a common human characteristic, which is mostly bad when you're the people in power and you have the power to hurt others. Racism is the belief in the inferiority of racial or ethnic groups. Notice we kind of tack ethnic groups in there. Or antipathy, that is believing they're inferior or not liking them, and the actions that are implied by such beliefs. So we don't ever know exactly what somebody believes, but if somebody's behavior is what you would do if you believed somebody else was inferior or you did not like that group, then that's racist behavior. We don't really have to get into identifying exactly what people think or feel or believe. It's hard to do. That discriminatory behavior, that racist behavior, may be individual, as prejudice actions against members of minority groups, which are those behaviors that would be implied by racist views. And then there's the institutional dimension, that discrimination that's practiced by political and social institutions, by governments and schools and employers, and so on. And you'll hear the word systemic racism, which is related to institutional discrimination in this definition. So there's a set of beliefs, a set of practices, and then there are practices that are at the individual and the institutional level, making up race and racism. Now, in walking that fine line between wanting to understand racial differences and racial inequality and yet not wanting to give too much weight or give too much naturalness to the categories that we know are not functionally real biologically, we do have to collect data on these things. It would be in some ideal world, maybe we wouldn't, we don't live in that ideal world. We need the data so we can understand the problems and so we can address race and racism. So the general scheme that most people use comes from the United States Census, our main government agency for collecting data about people, about the population, including about their race and ethnicity. The way we do it now, and this has changed many times over the years, is in two questions. The first question is, are you Hispanic or Latino or Spanish in origin? This is a yes or no question. Not asking if you're Black or white or anything else, just are you Hispanic or Latino or Spanish origin or Latinx, as some people would say. And you can say no, or you can say yes, yes Mexican, yes Puerto Rican, yes Cuban, yes other. Okay, so that's yes or no. And then they go to the second question and they ask, okay, so what is your race? Is it white? And then they ask you to give some example, for example, German, Irish, English. Or is it Black or African American? For example, you can write African American or Jamaican or Haitian. So you notice here they're mixing sort of race and ethnicity here. You're white and German, you're Black and Haitian. So there's kind of a race and ethnic mixing going on here. And then they don't even have a category Asian, because a lot of Asian people from Asian ancestry in the United States don't really think of themselves as an Asian race. There may be more recent ancestors, they might think of themselves as Chinese or Filipino or Vietnamese or Korean. So the question here is just sort of a bunch of checkboxes from representing Asian countries, and then they'll put all that together and call that group of people who checked any of those boxes Asian or Pacific Islander if they checked Samoan or Chamorro or one of those. And then there's some other race. Some other race is just like, if you can't find it on here, you may as well put some other race and we'll work it out later. One of the big categories of some other race, the biggest category by far, are Latinos who are not sure what to say on the race question. So maybe they actually are of some indigenous ancestry in Latin America, or maybe they aren't sure if they should say white. So a lot of people check some other race and write in something like Mexican or Hispanic or something like that. So a lot of people are basically using both of these questions to say the same thing twice. So we do end up with a bunch of some other race people that are Hispanic and might not actually think of themselves as having multiple identities. So it's a slightly problematic set of categories. Census Bureau tried to fix it and make it better. The Trump administration killed that plan because they were afraid it would lead to less whites being counted. It's a long story. So what do you get when you give this questionnaire to everybody in America or to a very, very large sample of millions of people? This is what you get. This figure here is from my book, The Family. And we broke everybody down into one and only one category. So the big yellow box are people who are white and are not Hispanic or any other race, just white and not Hispanic. That's about 200 million, about 61% of the total. Then those next three orange bars are Hispanics. They can be either white or some other race or other races or multiple races. And again, a lot of that is just saying Hispanic more than once. So that's about 59 million people or about 18% of people, the second largest group now. Blacks are the third largest group, about 12%, that's about 40 million. Asians, about 18 million. And then you see that sliver down, the smaller groups, American Indians, Pacific Islanders, and then the multiple race people who are not Hispanic. As you can see, there are not very many people who are multiple race who are not also Hispanic, about less than 8 million. Okay, so that's how you break down the whole population, and you should basically know these numbers. You should basically know the U.S. is about 60% white, non-Hispanic, 18, 12, 6, and less than 1 for the other category. So let's get those numbers baked into your general consciousness of what is the U.S. population by the categories that we use commonly in society, which are not biological categories. Now, one of the reasons this is contentious, race has always been contentious. Again, every racial system has always been a hierarchical system, so that means there's always going to be conflict and tension. In the United States, one of the issues in the last 50 years has been immigration and the changing composition of the population. This goes back 120 years to show you, just put that kind of change in context for the changing US population, especially as you notice the Hispanic group has now become the second largest group. This is how it happened. 110 years ago, almost 15% of the population was born in a different country. The vast majority of those were born in Europe or Canada. So we had a large immigrant population at that time, and they were almost all from Europe or Canada. So that's Eastern Europe, the Jews, Germany, and Ireland, and all those people who had come over the decades before that that were still alive. That was the immigrant population, Italians. Could name a bunch more. Okay. Then over time, that group aged, died, and their children became US born. And then starting with immigration reform in the 1960s, a big increase in immigration again, especially Latinos and Asians. So from Latin America to Caribbean and Asia, the biggest groups that have now really radically reshaped the American population. I mean, you can see we're back up over 14% of the total population is foreign born, and the vast majority of those from Latin America, the Caribbean, or Asia. So in the racist mind, we solved the problem of all the Europeans coming, including the kind of iffy ones that weren't totally white, like Jews and Italians or Irish people originally. So we got those people mostly integrated as whites. And now we have this big influx of other people who are sort of debatably whether or not we are going to end up counting them as white or not white. And it's rising diversity and it's threats to the national identity and there's racism and conflict and xenophobia. And this is basically a big part of our politics today. Because in addition to so that was just immigration, the number of people who are foreign born, but what is this doing to the overall composition of the United States? Here we are 2020, that middle bar, you can see the biggest bar is still those white non-Hispanics. There's Hispanic, the second biggest group, then Black, then Asian Pacific Islander up there. And the Census Bureau projections are that the white population is basically going to start declining now because whites are older and have relatively low birth rates. And the Hispanic population especially is going to keep growing. It's a younger population with higher birth rates, more recent immigrants, more young adults who have more children. So over the next 40 years, eventually the Census Bureau projects the non-Hispanic whites will become a minority in the population. Okay, now this assumes a lot of things about how the children of children of children of people of different groups will identify themselves. So if a white person and a Hispanic person get married and have children, and then they have children with someone else who's white, like, will that person be Hispanic? Well, it's up to them. They'll say whatever they want. It depends what they experience as a group, as individuals. Is there racism against them? Do they live in separate communities? Do they integrate with the wider white-dominated majority or what? So this is not gospel. This is not what's going to happen. This is just where we're headed right now with the numbers that are going on. And this partly explains things like the violent reaction against that idealistic image we saw at the beginning of sort of race mixture, and we're all one people and we all live together, and we all are on a journey to find ourselves and our true selves, and we're all mixed up in this world. To a lot of people, that's very threatening, and that underlies a lot of racism and xenophobia that we have in society today.